Thank you. So I'm gonna thanks for organizing this event, and great to see many faces in the room that we know are interested in these things and have been working on this in the past. So what I'm gonna be doing is kind of try to kind of start from, you know, where we stopped and think forward, both building on what James and what Sarah was just discussing. So I'm gonna say a little bit about, just to make sure that we're all on the same page, on kind of, and coming back to, you know, the studies that James presented were indeed kind of focused on farm level. That's certainly not the only NRM work that's happening in the CG. And you know, SPIA is very well aware of that. Say a little bit more about other impact assessments. But in particular, doing that to not just saying what we've done, but more importantly, kind of what are the gaps, kind of what are the findings, not just of what SPIA has been doing, but what the impact assessments in general on NRM research have been doing, and what does that suggest in terms of where the gaps are. Insights from the workshop we just had, which kind of started from these findings that, the past studies have presented and moving forward, and there I'm going to be building on that in terms of thinking of the challenges and the priorities going ahead. So just on the CGR and the research agenda, it's both, you know, micro and macro. It's not just the farm level. It's clearly not just the farm level work. And what is important in terms of thinking of impact assessment for this type of technology is that the direct objectives of that research agenda is both environmental and social benefits. And so when we think of impacts, that's kind of obviously has to be at the corner of what we do. And it's a bit of a question on whether that's been the case in the past. So it spans kind of productivity-related work, but also resource conservation, restoration work, work on policy, on governance, management of natural resources, and then the human environmental health and related to pollution reduction. So this is a graph from trying to kind of, just to put the context, I think very often when we say CGR, to people that don't spend a lot of time thinking about it, they think breeding. And so this is data on the CGR expenditures in different research areas from, I know this is a little bit small, but so basically from the beginning of the 70s to 2006, and I'll show you in a second the more recent numbers or some more recent numbers. And so indeed, in the 70s, most of percentage-wise, most of the expenditures were on crop production systems, or production systems in general. And so the brown bar here is protecting the environment. And so over time, the part on directly on protecting the environment has clearly, does the clicker work? No, it doesn't work. Has clearly increased. So the blue bar, the production system, a lot of that is actually production systems, it's not breeding. And so if you count everything together more or less, what is NRM research? You get to about, you know, 380 million and 70, 80 million in this period. There was a big shift in after 88, when the IPCC predecessor, the TAC, had a paper on sustainability, conservation, and management of NR, and a number of new centers that came into the system. And of course, the other bar here, the yellow one is the NARS, strengthening NARS, and then the other one that has increased a lot in terms of percentages is policy work, and a lot of that, some of that is also not a lot of, well, a fair amount of that is also NRM related. These are percentages. Of course, the budget has increased over time and has further increased after 2006, after the world food crisis. So if we look at where are the planned investments kind of from in the current cycle, so 2017-2002, of the 5.3 billion funding that is requested, about 1.2 corresponds to what you think could think of as NRM, so natural resource and ecosystem serves about 15%, and another 7% on climate change related outcomes. So this is an important domain for the CG. Both historically and so increasingly so has been, and of course that reflects, you know, changes in the world at large. Hence, it's important to take stock of what we know about impacts and think about how should we think about impacts moving forward. So James has presented a set of recent studies, but you know, this is not the only thing that SPIA has been doing. It's also not DESB has only focused on farm level stuff. You know, we all stand on the shoulder of giants, and one of the giants sits right here. So there has been work on this in the past. So this is, there was a set of studies in 2006 on different types of, again, at different levels, farm level, but also things like forest management. There has been work on the policy, kind of looking at the impacts of the policy work related to NRM. And there has been a set of studies kind of focusing, trying to say, wait a minute, a lot of the work that has happened is focusing still on productivity, but the whole point of having an NRM research agenda is also about the environmental benefits, and so using non-market value techniques to look at some of those things. So this is the same set of studies that James already had up there. The reason why I'm putting them back up, so this is kind of what has happened over the last 5 years. Reason to put this back out here is kind of to make a point about the variety of methods that have been used also more recently. So some of these are indeed RCTs, but some of those are quasi-experimental approaches. Some of them are using panel data sets, kind of many kind of different practices. And indeed, as you notice, a combination of work, you know, most of these studies are kind of work of centers, researchers in the centers, but researchers with experts from kind of from different universities. Now, if you look at, so SPIA alone is not the only one doing work in this area. And so the word cloud here shows is kind of is the result of a review of impact assessments more general by the centers, by SPIA, by outsiders. And here this is organized by the technology that they focused on. And so the innovation, sorry, not the technology. And so the we see that there is clearly a large bias towards certain types of technology. So this is not, as I said, this is not just the work we've been showing, but potentially even more interesting, if we look at what those studies are looking at, we see that most of the studies are, well, not most of it, that we proportionally have people looking at yield. Which is a bit puzzling, given that this is NRM practices. Okay, so the kind of the studies that people are doing have been focusing a lot on yield, and I've also have focused a lot on determinants of adoption. I think kind of this workload to me kind of you know, illustrates a lot of the kind of the challenges that this literature faces and the hands that we should take forward. In part because, you know, it clearly should not just be adoption that we worry about, but adoption is a first step, right? Because if the change of practices itself is not happening, that change of practices can't have impact at different levels. The other kind of challenge, of course, is that it's hard enough to get one determinant of adoption straight, let alone kind of trying to understand all the different levels of adoption. If we look at the evidence that exists, so overall, if you look at the impact assessment studies, the evidence is mixed. There are some positive impacts on some results on, again, on yield, because that's what a lot of people look at. But you know, more interesting maybe on household income or food consumption. Some evidence on water savings, other input costs. Some evidence on tree cover, but you know, more of a mixed picture there. And so we see application. We start seeing kind of many different methods being used, including. As we saw in what James presented, the use of secondary data, so using remote sensing evidence, for instance, on land use or forest cover changes. Limited documentation of environmental outcomes. And so, this is kind of clearly in going ahead, something when you think about. A lot of evidence, a lot of it focuses on the project mode, so kind of at the micro level and before scaling potentially. And so overall, somewhat strikingly, in contrast with the crop genetic work, of the CG, kind of, you know, this lack of this bigger picture synthesized evidence or overall. And of course, a lot of that has a very good reason. And one of the very good reasons is that the for NRM, the attribution to CG is much more difficult, right? Because this is exactly because the outcome is not a narrow outcome, and because this happens at many different scales, not just at the micro, and not at the farm level, it is much more difficult to tease apart which part may be a CG. But that doesn't mean we shouldn't be looking at it. So what we have been doing for the last couple of days is having this kind of very interesting discussions between biophysical and social scientists, both researchers based in the CG and outside experts to kind of starting from the evidence that was presented earlier and saying, okay, where do we go from here? What does this mean for the NRM research agenda? What does it mean for the impact assessment agenda? And so starting from this low evidence, from this evidence of low levels of adoption of particular technologies particular practices, if you want to, on the farm level. And so the questions we're trying to understand why. Is it because these innovations are not beneficial for farmers? So there's questions about the development process and the testing of the innovations. Is it because farmers don't know these innovations or their returns? So that's related to questions of scaling up, of diffusion, but also questions about the type of practices we're talking about, so the complexity that James already referred to, and questions about whether those innovations possibly are not perceived beneficial to farmers, which should not be necessarily a surprise, because some of the benefits are not individual benefits. The environmental benefits is a clear example, and I will use the word externality as a microeconomist, social returns being higher than private returns. Social returns being higher than private returns for many of those technologies, but also that a lot of the returns are long-term, even for the individual farmer, and hence maybe, you know, given discounting, given all kind of liquidity and other constraints, there's good reasons why they may be discounting those type of benefits, which then also kind of leads to questions of what should we be measuring, how should we be measuring things. So some general thoughts coming out of the workshop is, first of all, kind of this idea that we should stop thinking about adoption of technologies and more think in terms of what this research does is providing principles for changing practices, principles that could underlay changes in practices that are not specific technologies. So in a certain way, when we look at microdosing, we're not necessarily interested in the microdosing per se. We're interested in the soil fertility changes, and that's kind of the more general principle. So that's kind of, and part of that work goes through changes at the farm level, but part of it is through changes in discourses at the meso level, at the macro level. So there's a question on how do we document that, and what are the type of methodological developments that we need to look at these different levels and the interlinkages. And this is, again, going directly back at the attribution challenge that I already referred to. But the other thing that even for the farm level research, there was a lot of interesting discussions about is that a lot of this research, of the NRM research, is not linear in the sense that it is not necessarily true that the way you want to think of this research is kind of saying, okay, you have a development stage, and then you test it, and then you diffuse it. But rather that because of the complexity of the benefits and the costs, you may have something that is developed, you test it, you realize it doesn't really lead to the benefits or costs that you realize, and you may go back to the development stage, or you may go to the diffusion stage, and you may have to get that. So it's a non-linear process. And so the idea of this being linear for this particular domain in terms of also how we think about impact assessment is probably not necessarily the way forward. So, and what this suggests then is that in terms of impact assessment, we want to think about these different steps in the causal chain and how we think about saying something kind of insightful about that. So I'm way out of time. I want to say the most important thing still. So one of the key insights is the question about, in terms of the research agenda forward, the goal should not be that kind of one of the obvious consensus in a certain way of this of the workshop is the goal is not that all farmers adopt all innovations. Farmers are heterogeneous, and so that suggests we need to be able to target. But targeting here is difficult because it's not clear ex ante, again, given the complexity of the benefits and the costs, which farmer will actually benefit on net from which type of innovation or technology. And so what that then suggests is that, and indeed there was some work that was presented, the targeting on observables turns to be difficult, so we need to understand farmers' objectives. We can use revelation mechanisms whether that's on a small scale, it could be things like auctions, but on a bigger scale, it could be through willingness to pay, through having farmers choose between technologies and experiment, and then use the insights from that to scale up subsequently. So partly this suggests experimentation with larger ends, so good participation, but not with a few farmers, but with many farmers, to learn more in the process. And also, and again, this was kind of discussed, the idea that when we do that, so that kind of, and that goes back to the non-linearity, means that when also for the measurement and for the impact assessment, it's kind of, we want to be thinking of learning also in a certain way, in a circular way. It's not just that first, as the biophysical scientist, I test something, and then I take it to the field, and then the farmer learns about it. Because if it's non-iterative, it is iterative, non-linear, then we need to think about how the farmers is perceiving a technology. What does that mean for me understanding, me the researcher, understanding the cost and the benefits, and then try to measure that and bringing together the biophysical and the social science insights. Lots of questions about measurements. Again, if we are not just interested, we're certainly not just interested in yield in this agenda. If we're also not just interested in productivity, we kind of need to go make sure that we measure those other benefits when we do work on this, including the spillovers and the externalities. And we need to go beyond the short term. And so clearly here, this is, again, given the complexity of these practices, given this is about changing principles about the way people do things, that takes time. People may try it, and then may they decide that it's not worth it. And so kind of the idea of thinking much more longer term in this agenda, having panels, having long-term follow-ups, et cetera. And that's only going to be feasible with a combination of different methods, so using household service, remote sensing, et cetera. And finally, in terms of the diffusion of scale, I'm going to say very little because I'm really out of time. But the idea is that we need to start, when we think of diffusion, thinking through, okay, what are the private and the social benefits? If the benefits are more social, that suggests a different diffusion mechanism than if they're private, by definition. If the constraints to using certain technologies or innovations, practices, could be information, but it could be other type of mechanisms, that other constraints that we need to address there. And as James already said, there's a lot of kind of interesting work happening outside of the CG that we may want to draw on in terms of insights on scaling. And I'll stop right there.